Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome everyone here this morning for our joint service of St. John's and Emmanuel. So we got the mixed praise band here this morning. So great seeing everyone here this morning. Special welcome to our guests and our visitors. We praise your time here as a blessing for you this morning. Our order of service is a printed order of service in our bulletins this morning. So everything you'll need is right here in the bulletin. And so this is Holy Trinity Sunday. And so the theme of the service and the hymns are all going to be focused on God, the Holy Trinity. And so our first hymn this morning is going to be hymn number 500, Creator Spirit by Whose Aid. That's our opening hymn. Please note the final verse is a Trinitarian verse, and so we'll stand on that verse. God's richest blessings be with each and every one of you. Let's go ahead and be good in that opening hymn.
Spirit. As we hold the Catholic faith, the Athanasian Creed refers must above all hold the Catholic faith.
Whoever does not keep it will hold undefiled, but without doubt ever is eternal.
And the Catholic faith is this:
that we worship one God in Trinity, and Trinity in unity, neither confessing the persons nor dividing the substance.
For the Father is one person, the Son is another, the Holy Spirit is another.
But the Godhead of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit is one. The glory is equal, and the majesty co-eternal.
Such as the Father is, such is the Son, and such is the Holy Spirit.
The Father uncreated, the Son uncreated, the Holy Spirit uncreated.
The Father infinite, the Son infinite, the Holy Spirit infinite.
The Father eternal, the Son eternal, the Holy Spirit eternal.
And yet there are not three eternals, but one eternal.
Just as there are not three uncreated, nor three infinite, but one uncreated and one infinite.
In the same way, the Father is almighty, the Son almighty, the Holy Spirit almighty.
And yet there are not three almighties, but one almighty.
So the Father is God, the Son is God, the Holy Spirit is God.
And yet there are not three gods, but one God.
So the Father is Lord, the Son is Lord, the Holy Spirit is Lord.
And yet there are not three lords, but one Lord.
Just as we are compelled by the Christian truth to acknowledge these distinct persons as God and Lord, so also are we prohibited by the Catholic religion to say that there are three gods or lords.
The Father is not made nor created nor begotten by anyone.
The Son is neither made nor created, but begotten of the Father alone.
The Holy Spirit is of the Father and of the Son, neither made nor created, nor begotten, but received.
Thus there is one Father, not three fathers, one Son, not three sons, one Holy Spirit, not three Holy Spirits.
And in this Trinity, none is before or after another, none is greater or less than another.
But the whole three persons are co-eternal with each other and co-equal, so that in all things, as has been stated above, the Trinity and unity and Trinity is the worship.
Therefore, whoever desires to be saved must think thus about the Trinity.
As we approach our triune God and gather in his majestic name, we draw near with true hearts and confess our sins.
Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Maker of all things, Judge of all people, we admit and confess our sinfulness.
We have turned away from one another in our thinking, speaking, and doing.
We have done the evil you forbid, and have not done the good you demand. We do repent and are truly sorry for these our sins.
Have mercy on us, Heavenly Father, because of the obedience of our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son.
Forgive us all that it is past, and with the power of the Holy Spirit, move us to serve you faithfully. Set our feet upon the new path of life, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name.
Jesus says, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. He alone, with the Father and the Spirit, is the one who has promised forgiveness to those who repent of their sins and turn to him. Therefore, as a called and ordained servant of the word, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God give you in his grace by the Holy Spirit and lead you to greater faith and obedience, and bring you to live with him forever through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We continue with the introit. Blessed be the Holy Trinity and the undivided unity.
Let us give glory to him because he has shown his mercy to us.
I accept the Lord always before me.
Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken.
Therefore my heart is glad and my whole being rejoices.
My flesh also dwells secure.
But you will not abandon my soul to Sheol.
Or let your Holy One see corruption.
You make known to me the path of life.
In your presence there is fullness. the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy on us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy on us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
And grant us your peace. Amen.
Please be seated for our next hymn. Holy God, we praise thy name.
God, you have given us grace to acknowledge the glory of the eternal Trinity by the confession of a true faith and to worship the unity and the power of the divine majesty. Keep us steadfast in this faith and defend us from all adversities. For you, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, live and reign, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. The Old Testament reading for this festival of the Holy Trinity comes to us from the Old Testament book of Proverbs, the 8th chapter. Does not wisdom call? Does not understanding raise her voice? On the heights above, on the heights beside the way, at the crossroads she takes her stand. Beside the gates in front of the town, at the entrance of the portal she cries aloud, "To you, O men, I call, and my cry is to the children of man. The Lord possessed me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts of old. Ages ago I was set up, at the first, before the beginning of the earth. When there was no depths, I was brought forth. Even there were no springs abounding with water. Before the mountains had been shaped, before the hills, I was brought forth. Before he had made the earth with his field, or the fruit of the dust of the world, when he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep, when he made firm the skies above, when he established the fountains of the deep, when he assigned to the sea its limits so that the waters might not transgress his command, when he marked out the foundations of the earth, then I was beside him like a master workman, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing before him always, rejoicing in his inhabited world, and delighting in the children of man." This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. We continue with the gradual. The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart.
The word of faith that we proclaim.
For with the heart one believes and is justified.
And with the mouth one confesses and is saved.
Our second reading this morning comes to us from the book of Acts, the 2nd chapter. Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them. "Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosening the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. For David says concerning him, 'I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad and my tongue rejoiced. My flesh also will dwell in hope, for you will not abandon my soul to Hades or let your Holy One see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life, and you will make me full of gladness with your presence. Brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God has sworn with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Christ, and he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, of all that we are all witnesses. Being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out on this what you yourselves are seeing and hearing. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he himself says, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand, until I make your enemies your footstool. Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified.' This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God." I invite you to stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is according to the Gospel of St. John, according to St. John, the 8th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. The Jews answered Jesus, "Are we not right in saying that you are a Samaritan and have a demon?" And Jesus answered, "I do not have a demon, but I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. Yet I do not seek my own glory. There is one who seeks it, and he is the judge. Truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death." The Jews said to him, "Now we know that you have a demon. Abraham died, and as did the prophets. Yet you say, if anyone keeps my word, he will never taste death." Are you greater than our father Abraham who died? And the prophets died. Who do you make yourself out to be?" Jesus answered, "If I glorify myself, my glory is nothing. It is my Father who glorifies me, of whom you say he is our God. But you have not known him. I know him. If I were to say that I do not know him, I would be a liar like you. But I do know him, and I keep his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day, and saw it, and he saw it and was glad." So the Jews said to him, "You are not yet 50 years old, and have you seen Abraham?" And Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am." And so they picked up stones to throw at him. But Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We continue with the confession of our Christian faith in the words of the Athanasian Creed. We speak part two of that this morning here on page 9. As we confess in this creed the work and identity of the one true God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, with all founded in and supported throughout the Scripture, the Athanasian Creed closes with a reminder of judgment and the last day to come. Though reference is made to works are not the basis of our salvation. Only those who by faith believe in Jesus Christ for salvation are able to do good works in God's sight. And the good works done are fruits of the saving faith in Christ given through the Holy Spirit. But it is also necessary for everlasting salvation that one faithfully believe the incarnation of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Therefore, it is the right faith that they believe and confess that our Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, is at the same time both God and man.
He is begotten from the substance of the Father before all ages, and he is man born from the substance of his mother in this age.
Perfect God and perfect man, composed of rational soul and human flesh.
Equal to the Father with respect to his divinity, less than the Father with respect to his humanity.
Although he is God and man, he is not two, but one Christ.
One, however, not by the conversion of divinity into flesh, but by the assumption of the humanity into God.
One altogether, not by confusion of substance, but by unity of person.
For as the rational soul and flesh is one man, so God and man is one Christ.
Who suffered for our salvation, descended into hell, rose again the third day of the dead.
Ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father, God Almighty, from whence he will come to judge the living and the dead.
At his coming, all people will rise again with their bodies and give an account concerning their own deeds.
Please be seated. We continue with the next hymn, Holy, 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 hymn number 507.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be with you from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, does it really matter what we believe and what we confess about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? I came across a poll this last week. It's found in the Christian Post, and it was done by the American Bible Society. And in this poll, they found that 38% of those in Generation Z, adults from 18 through 25, believe that Jesus sinned just like everybody else sins. In that poll, they also found that my generation, Gen X, was at 37%. Millennials and baby boomers were at 35%. So across these generations, roughly from 35 to 38% believe that Jesus was simply a sinner just like everyone else. Does that make a difference? Now, if Jesus was a sinner just like everyone else, he could not be the substitutionary atonement for us. He could not be the sacrificial lamb on our behalf who paid the price for the sins of the entire world. And if he did not pay for the sins of the entire world, then that means that you and I are still in our sins. And we are very much in a lot of trouble if that were to be the case. You see, if we get Jesus wrong, who Jesus is, what Jesus has done, we also get the Holy Trinity wrong, and who the Holy Trinity is, and what the Trinity has done for us. As Christians, we have a God who is different from all the other gods that are out there in this world today. Now, when we think about different gods and everything, we typically think of the various religions, right? Whether it be Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, you name it, whatever religion pops in your mind. But we're also talking about the idols that people make in their hearts as they take a little bit from this religion, a little bit from that religion, and they all wrap it into a God that they would like to worship, a God that they think ought to be, and a God that's really formed by their own imaginations and formed to fit their own tastes, as it were. But we have a God that is far different from that. We have a God who is beyond our imagination. We have a God who is revealed in his word as the Holy Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And it's the Son who came and took on human flesh, who died, who went to the cross, who rose again from the dead, so that you and I would have forgiveness and eternal life. It's this Jesus who is both God and man who says in the scriptures in John 10 verse 30 that I and the Father are one. And then Matthew 28:19, Jesus says this as he's given the great commission to go and make disciples, and he says, baptize in the name of God. And who's the God? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Jesus shows himself that he is true God, that he is one with the Father, not one in person, but one in divine essence, as he has also come to be our Savior. Now, there have been a lot of heresies, a lot of false teachings that have come into play over the last 2,000 years. Most of the religions or these false ideas of who Christ is and who God is came about because people did not want to misspeak about who God is. There's a lot of people that were saying, we know that there's one God, but they could not understand how Jesus could be God as well. And they thought if they would say that Jesus is God, then they would be opening themselves up to the charge of creating a new pantheon of gods, that there's more than one God. And of course, the early church meant to convene and to discuss what this means, you know, and who God truly is. And so councils were met, and as such, they came out. What came out of those councils were creeds, were confessions, like the one we were confessing this morning with the Athanasian Creed, by saying who God is and who Jesus is. Today, just as a matter of historical note, is the 1,697th anniversary of the Council of Nicaea that met in the year of our Lord, 325. And as that council met, it meant to define who God is. You know, who the scriptures say God is, and who do the scriptures say Jesus is. And what came out of this council was the Nicene Creed. The creed that was formally ratified in 381. But both the Nicene Creed and the Athanasian Creed not only describe in great detail who God is and who God is not, they also describe in great detail about the person and work of Jesus Christ. And the Athanasian Creed is very clear. If one is to be saved, one must hold on to this one true faith of who God is, the Trinity in unity and the unity in Trinity, but also who Christ is. And so the Creed says, therefore, it is the right faith that we believe and confess that our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is at the same time both God and man. And so we're saying that he is one with the Holy Trinity, one of the same substance, but yet he has taken on our humanity as he was was incarnate in his mother's womb and brought into this earth in time and place to be our Savior. This is the Son of God who came and took on our flesh so that he could live that perfect life that you and I could not live. He took on our flesh, only it was without sin. But later on, he would go to the cross where all the sins of the world would be placed upon him. And he would pay the price through the shedding of his holy and his precious blood for your sins, for my sins, and for the sins of all the world. This is the Christ whom we confess to believe in. This is the God of the Scriptures and the God that the Church has always proclaimed. And so the Creed says, this is the Catholic or the universal Christian faith, that whoever does not believe it faithfully and firmly cannot be saved. And the reason being is that if you have a different idea of who God is, you have a false God or a false Christ. But God has called us to faith in baptism, to the one true faith, to the one true God who is revealed in the Holy Scriptures. But there have been many false ideas about who Christ is. During the time of the Nicene Creed, it was the Arian controversy. Who here remembers what the Arian controversy was all about? Nobody. Okay. Arian controversy was started by a man named Arius. And Arius was saying this, that Jesus could not be God. Okay, and so he was simply a creature that God had made. And so he was given the title Son of God simply because of his holiness, his righteousness. And of course, this would set up a totally different Christ. And so the Council of Nicaea met, and they condemned that heresy. But that heresy is still around today. Would you actually believe that? It's still here today. The most recent incarnation of that is with the Jehovah Witnesses. You see, the Jehovah Witnesses teach that Jesus is not true God, but that he was a creature, and that he didn't take on human flesh. It just appeared that he did so, and that he just appeared to arise from the dead. But if he simply just appeared to do that and really didn't do that, then he really didn't die for us, and he really didn't rise for us. And so it's an attack not only on who God is and who Christ is, but it's an attack on the good news itself. You see, what we believe truly does make a huge difference in the world today. I came across another interesting statistic. It says this, that 37% of all pastors in the United States today have a biblical worldview. 37%. That means 73% do not have a biblical worldview, do not have a biblical understanding of the Bible and what the Bible teaches, whether it be the various doctrines or who God is. Now, I hear a lot of people say over the years, does it really matter what church you go to? Absolutely, it makes a huge difference. It makes a difference because if you go to a church that does not confess the one true God, and or you're not hearing preached the one true God and who He is, that leads you away from the true Christ. It leads you away from the true God. But the thing is this, is that God wants to be known. That's the good news. God wants to be known. He gives us an entire book. I don't know if you've heard of it. It's called the Bible, right? And He's given us His Word so that we may read that Word, study that Word, meditate on that Word. And as we do so, God reveals who He is. And He reveals that He is triune, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. He reveals that His Son is our Savior. And at the same time, He also reveals who you are and who I am. That we have been made to be children of the one true God through holy baptism. As we've been, as we have had His name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit placed upon us in our baptism, as He claims us as His very own. This is the one true God. This is the God that is different than all the other gods of the world. When you think about all the gods that are fashioned in the world, even maybe the false gods and the false idols that we love to create within our own hearts and minds, what have those gods done for you that really helped? What have those gods done for you that they didn't demand something from you? Either you had to be a certain way or be perfect in this one area, or you had to do certain things in order to be made right with God. And the thing is, this is that nothing. They all demand things. Even the idols that we create in our own hearts always demand something of us. And yet we have a God who demands nothing. We have a God who gives everything. A God who gives His Son for you. A God whose Son dies for you, gives His life for you, and calls you to be His own. A God who comes to you each day, a God who comes to you here each week to nourish you, not only through His Word, but also through His Holy Supper, and feeds and nourishes that gift of faith that you have received in your baptism. We have a God who gives rather than takes. And we see so many gods out there in this world who are always competing for your love, who are always competing for your attention. And how many times do we give in to those gods? How many times do we simply say, yes, I'm going to go off and do this, and it costs me time with God on Sunday morning? You see, those gods expect certain things, or maybe you cannot participate. But we have a God who loves us none the same. A God who is always there, who always calls us to Himself, who always picks us up, who heals us of our wounds, and who forgives all of our sins. Does it truly matter what we believe and what we confess about Jesus? The answer is yes. It makes an eternal difference. But when we get Jesus right, when we have the correct understanding of who He is, then we get the correct understanding of the Trinity and who He is and what He has done for us. And then when we have that right, then we know we are in the one true faith, the one holy, Catholic, or Christian, and apostolic faith. And for that, may God receive all the thanks, all the praise, and all the glory. In the name of our one triune God, amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Savior to life everlasting. Amen. At this time, we will gather our offerings. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Blessed Father, from you comes all that is, and we are forever indebted to your grace for the gift of life. Receive this day our special thanks for the redemption you have provided in Jesus Christ, your Son, and for the work of the Spirit in bringing us to know you by faith and to be adopted as your children by baptism into the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Bless the Father, you desire not the death of the sinner, but that all may live. Grant your Holy Spirit that hearing your word, all people may be brought to repentance and may confess with us faith in Jesus Christ as Lord. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Blessed Father, you have revealed yourself to us in Christ that we may know you by faith and confess you before the world. Give us your Spirit that all churches may confess truly and faithfully your word and live in harmony of doctrine and life in anticipation of that day when we shall kneel together at your altar. Lord, in your mercy. Blessed Father, you have established marriage and sanctified the home to be a place of blessing and love. Give to parent and child the courage to love as you have loved us. Unite them in their common life by your Spirit to know Jesus and serve him. Bless the single with chastity, comfort the widowed, protect the orphan, and defend the helpless. Lord, in your mercy. Blessed Father, you guard our world as your own possession and have established governments and leaders to serve your purposes. Bless our president, our governor, and all elected and appointed officials that in their stewardship of the nation and state they may be faithful and serve honorably for our benefit. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Blessed Father, be with all those who have lost crops and property in the storms this last week and even last night. We pray that you would bless them in their recovery and replanting efforts. And we pray that you would bless us with timely rainfall, rainfall without hail or wind or tornadoes. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Blessed Father, you have suffered fully for the cost of love through your Son. Give healing and peace to all the afflicted, the grieving, and the dying, especially those who are included in our prayers today, including Bruce Houghton, Cliff Lacey, Betty Krause, Esther Beathy, Tony Lentz, Darlene Dinsey, Chris Kelly, Haley McDonald, Shirley Bartles, Robert Dinsey, Leroy Beathy, Shirley Fry, Jim Bornpaul, Emma Walters, Laverne Bartles, Sophie Carnegie, Sean Otmer, and all those we name in our hearts before you. Give them all that is needful, that they may endure their illness confident of your presence. Supply them with grace sufficient for every time of need. Lord, in your mercy. Blessed Father, your Son was the voice that spoke all things into existence, and your grace still preserves all that you have made. You did not abandon your people when they abandoned you, but you have delivered us by the blood of Christ. Grant us your Spirit that we may know your word and keep it in faith through all the days of our earthly pilgrimage until we are joined with faithful Abraham, with patriarch, apostle, and prophet and evangelist in your presence forevermore. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Receive the benediction of our triune God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant to you his peace. Amen. Please be seated for our closing hymn, hymn 506, Glory Be to God the Father.
Thank you.
At this time, we'll continue with our stewardship moment for the month.
Hello. Today is Holy Trinity Sunday. The Holy Trinity is a community of persons, three persons and one divine being. When God created the world and humanity, it was so that we could be in the community with him, and as such, that we may also be in a community with one another. When sin disrupted that community between us and God and between us and one another, Jesus came to restore it through his life, death, resurrection, and ascension into heaven. In Acts 2, verses 44 through 47, Luke records, "And all who believed were together and had all things in common, and they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all, as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. And all of this is because of the fellowship that they had with one another." As we read through the book of Acts, we see the church united together, but whenever human distinctions would be made among the believers, then divisions crept in to disrupt that unity. Luke again records in Acts 2, verse 42, "And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers." The fellowship that they had with one another in Christ was reaffirmed when they came together in worship and receiving the Lord's Supper together. It was also reaffirmed in the fellowship and the care they gave and received from one another. The fellowship that we share as a dual parish is a microcosm of the fellowship that we have with all our brothers and sisters in Christ in the Missouri Synod. As Synod, we walk together and care for one another. Today, we have rejoiced in that fellowship as we receive Christ's gifts to us in the service. And now we get to rejoice in the fellowship as we enjoy a meal and the holy conversation among brothers and sisters. It is never just me and Jesus, nor is it just our congregation and Jesus or our dual parish and Jesus, but it is you, me, Jesus, and the body of Christ together in a holy fellowship with the Holy Trinity. As the psalmist says in Psalm 133, verse 1, "Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity." Thank you.
Thank you, Amy. A few announcements this morning. Just a quick reminder, if you haven't checked your mailboxes back there for a while, please do so. Some are getting kind of full, but there's also some t-shirts back there. If you're at BBS this past week, t-shirts kind of came in late, so we stuffed them in mailboxes back there as well. So please check your mailboxes this morning. I'd like to thank all those volunteers and helpers, those who organized VBS this last week, those who brought food, those who cooked, and all those helped out in any way, thank you so very much. It was truly a blessing for the kids the past week. I believe we had 17 kids come this week and hear about Jesus and his salvation for them. Also, I'd like to thank Aaron Kinney, who donated fertilizer for the parsonage and for the beautification of the church lawn. So thank you very much for that. Thank you to all those who helped take care of the flower beds around the church, outside here and around all the grounds. Thank you so much. If you haven't checked your area for a while, please do so. As with all the rain and everything, I know the weeds are really popping up and going. So please keep that area tidied up if you could, please. Also, in 2 weeks from today, for those here at St. John's, we'll be having a special voters meeting that'll take place at their church. It's going to be a short meeting, but we're going to talk about scholarship funds, and that will be the only topic of discussions. That's in 2 weeks on June the 26th. Today we have a special guest with us, Bob Sager, who is president for Lutherans for Life here in Nebraska, is here, and he's here to present an award to Madeline. There was an essay contest on life and the value of life, and so I'll invite both of them to please come forward as President Sager will talk a little bit about that, and Madeline will read that essay.
How would you define blessed? One dictionary definition for blessed is enjoying great happiness. While we are certainly blessed for life by God through what he gives us, food, drink, clothing, shoes, house, home, land, animals, money, goods, good friends, faithful neighbors, and the like, there is another definition for blessed that we often forget about, bringing comfort or joy. So what does it mean to bring comfort or joy? Who can do it? God brings comfort and joy to life. Take, for example, adoption. According to Adoption Network, experts estimate that between 1 and 2 million couples are waiting to adopt. Many of these couples want to adopt because they cannot have their own biological children, whether from infertility or from the mother having underlying health issues. At the time, it may seem like God does not care, that he does not want them to have kids. This idea is not necessarily true. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to give you a future and a hope." God has a plan for their lives. He plans to preserve them and to bless them for life, as we see in Psalm 41:2. The Lord protects him and keeps him alive. He is called blessed in the land. You do not give him up to the will of his enemies. Even though it will take time to accept their situation, God has promised to bless them with his comfort throughout their struggles. These couples will also go through the grieving process because of the loss of their ability to have children. They will try to deny the fact that they just cannot have kids. They will get angry and depressed, but God has made a promise to them. I will turn their mourning into joy. I will comfort them and give them gladness for sorrow. Our God is the God of all comfort, and he himself comforts them, as written in 2 Thessalonians 2:16 and 17. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort, comfort your hearts. God will certainly comfort their hearts by turning their sorrows into joy. And when the time comes, he will bless them for life by giving them a child to raise as their own through adoption. God's word says, "Train up a child in the way he should go. Even when he is old, he will not depart from it." Children are a heritage from the Lord. Raising them to read and learn God's word is the legacy that they will pass down from generation to generation. What a joy it will be for the parents to see their adopted son or daughter passing what they learned from their parents to their sons and daughters. Teaching God's word to their children from the time they are small should be every parent's joyful response to the blessing of children that God has given them. Our God truly is the God of joy and the God of comfort. He himself gives us comfort. He turns our sorrows into joy. He blesses us through his word, which points us to him. So how would I define blessed? I would define blessed as God comforting us and turning our sorrow into joy. We are indeed blessed for life.
Yes, thank you, Madeline. I guess one thing that I'd like to share or point out is that someone like Madeline, as much as you know, we can appreciate what she has said, what she's written, what she understands, it didn't come poof out of the air. It came in her upbringing, it came in her family life, encouragement of her friends, her Sunday school teachers, whatever it may be. So I'd encourage the rest of you young people out here to encourage each other, share the love that you have for God with each other, and then parents and grandparents, share that with your children and grandchildren as well, so that they can know that blessing and have that blessing in their life. So thank you, Madeline. This is a certificate. It simply says 2022 Lutherans for Life Nebraska Essay Contest, first place for the grade 9 through 12 category.
And thank you very much, President Sager. And again, we'll keep Lutherans for Life in our prayers and our thoughts and our minds as they continue that ministry of promoting life in the world as well. So thank you very much. On the way out, Mal will be there to greet on the way out this morning.